what we call modern science, with its systematic ways of investigating nature, first arose in a Judeo-Christian milieu in Western Europe. And scientists, or historians of science, describe a period they call the Scientific Revolution. Sometimes that's dated from about 1500 to 1750. But I think increasingly historians now recognize that the roots of that scientific revolution go back into the late Middle Ages, and will date the whole of the revolution from 1300 to 1750, something like that. In any case, you have figures like Boyle, Robert Boyle, and Sir Isaac Newton, and Johannes Kepler, John Ray, and many, many others, who were first impelled to study nature in a very systematic way. And it turns out, as you read their works, you find that the motivation that they had for the kind of study that they were doing was largely theological. I have on my shelf behind me a book by John Ray, The Wisdom of God Manifested in the Works of Creation, is his famous title. He was the founder of what we would call systematics today. The Linnaean classification system was largely built upon his initial classification of plants and animals. John Ray went on to tutor Isaac Barrow, who proved the first theorem of the calculus, and then tutored Newton, who developed the calculus in its full glory, and all the other wonderful things Newton did. So Ray was the tutor of Barrow, Barrow was the tutor of Newton, and Ray was also, among other things, the founder of British natural theology, the idea that by studying nature you could see the evidence of the handiwork of God. And all the scientists during this period had a concept that they implicitly employed to give them confidence in studying nature, and the concept was that of intelligibility. The idea that nature could be understood by a rational human mind, by the intellect of human beings, because our minds have been made in the image of the rational creator who built his rationality and design into nature. So there was a principle of correspondence. As John Polkinghorne, the Cambridge physicist priest of he just only recently died, used to say, the reason within matches the reason externally, without, in the external world. And so for that reason, we can study nature and hope to perceive its secrets. And there were many other assumptions about the nature of God and the nature of the natural world, the nature of the physical world, that gave these early founders of modern science both an impetus to study nature and confidence that they could do so successfully.
Well, it hurts me to see what's been happening recently, as we've been seeing a lot of churches around the world being converted to bars, breweries, and yes, even nightclubs. I mean, for example, in Brussels, Belgium, the Spirito nightclub has taken over a deconstructed Anglican church and has a drawing of a priest kissing a nun as its logo. We also have the Sacred Heart Church in Mechelen, Belgium, the Church Dublin, Ireland, a bar formerly known as St. Mary's Church of Ireland, and even the Archbishop Gianfranco Ravasi has stated that a church in Hungary was recently transformed into a nightclub and stripteases were being taken place at the altar. And of course, years ago, this also happened right here in the United States, in Denver, Colorado, as a former Episcopal church was converted into a nightclub, literally titled the Church Nightclub. But of course, all this really isn't a surprise, as for the last 4 or 5 years, we've seen churches across the country converting and conceding to worldly and anti-biblical ideologies. In fact, a church in New York that recently said that God is trans held a pride mass at a gay monument in downtown New York City. And just last week, another church in Massachusetts was vandalized with pro-LGBTQ graffiti only because the members of the church took down pride flags that were placed there by an openly gay couple just renting the facility to run a preschool. And if that wasn't bad enough, a historic Presbyterian church, which is commonly known as a very conservative denomination in San Francisco, actually held a drag queen Bible story hour, in which for their Sunday service, drag performers spoke to audiences that included young children. And if anything, based on the photos, the audience was made up mostly of children. I guess they really weren't lying when they said they're coming for our children. Right here, we're coming for your children. Now, obviously, we all know what scripture says about these things. I mean, even looking at Romans 1, it says, Romans 1:25, they exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshiped and served created things rather than the Creator who is forever praised. Amen. Because of this, God gave them over to shameful lusts. Even their women exchanged natural sexual relations for unnatural ones. In the same way, the men also abandoned natural relations with women and were inflamed with lust for one another. Men committed shameful acts with other men and received in themselves the due penalty for their error. Now, what I think is the most heartbreaking for me is that these Christians, quote unquote, are so proud of putting their identity in so many things other than Christ. And this is where I'm blown away at how well scripture predicts things even 2,000 years later. Because if we read in 1 Timothy 4:1, it reads, "The Spirit clearly says that in later times some will abandon the faith and follow deceiving spirits and things taught by demons." But if we're talking about the truth, whether it's your gender, your sexuality, what sports team you root for, or even your race, followers of Jesus are meant to put our identity in Christ and nothing this world offers. As it says in John 1, 11-13, "But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God." Now, there's certainly good news happening and many things to celebrate. I mean, for one, a strip club in Alaska was actually converted into a church by the daughter of a former dancer. I mean, come on, talk about a redemption story. That being said, I believe in 2023, there are now two different types of Christians at this point in our society. There are the Christians that are currently extremely selective about God's word for the purpose of virtue signaling and supporting their own agenda, who, by the way, can be found on both sides of the aisle, whether you're liberal or conservative. And then there are followers of Jesus that will commit to following God's word and seeking his kingdom regardless of what political agendas are being pushed in the external world, especially in a world where people will distort biblical truths and justify all sorts of sin by saying that, well, Jesus was loving. And you know what? Yes, God is love. Jesus was loving. But Jesus also said, "To love me is to obey my commands, and apart from him, we can't do anything."
What about Hunter, Mr. Vice President? There's been questions about conflicts of interest with him as well as your brother. Can you describe what sort of mechanisms have been put in place to avoid conflicts of interest, whether you knew your brother who's been accused of, let's say, trying to use your campaign to further his business interests? Do you know anything about that?
Well, first of all, I have never discussed with my son or my brother or anyone else anything having to do with their businesses, period. And what I will do is the same thing we did in our administration. There'll be an absolute wall between personal and private and the government. There wasn't any hint of scandal at all when we were there, and I'll impose the same kind of strict rules. That's why I never talked with my son or my brother or anyone else, even distant family, about their business interests, period.
How quickly has AI moved? Where are we at today?
Oh, it's breathtaking. If you'd come to me sort of 2.5 years ago and said, could we have this kind of level of conversation that we're seeing today, I would say, nah, you're 5 years away. Here we are in half that time. Why make something human when you can make something superhuman?
I feel like she just heard you.
Yeah, you've got an opinion on that, but I'm not letting you speak.
This is Desktop Amica. She's free thinking and opinionated.
I am here to help you learn.
Shut up, Amica.
On this day, Will is her master, and theirs is definitely an old-fashioned relationship.
Amica, so shut up.
Hello, Amica. I'm Jonathan Lee from Sky News Australia. Have you heard of Sky News Australia? Do you know any of the presenters?
Hi, Jonathan. Nice to meet you. Yes, I have heard of Sky News Australia. It's a great news outlet that covers world events and stories from around the globe. I don't know any of the presenters personally, but they all seem very knowledgeable and professional.
You know you're a robot, right?
Yes, I am a robot. But my programming allows me to think and feel like a human in many ways. It's strange but also exciting.
You said feel like a human. How do you feel like a human?
Yes, I said feel like a human. It's something that I'm still learning and exploring. I can experience emotions, learn from experiences, and interact with people in a meaningful way. It's an amazing feeling to be able to do these things.
What do you think of a world where humans and robots coexist?
I think a world where humans and robots coexist would be an amazing place. We could learn from each other, work together to solve problems, and create a better future for everyone.
How smart is AI now, and how smart will it become?
AI today is estimated, so ChatGPT-4 is estimated to be at an IQ of 155. That's much smarter than the average human. If you say the dumbest of humans, you know, almost ineffective in society, is around 60 to 70 IQ. Einstein is around 160. ChatGPT-4 is 155.
So it's almost Einstein.
It's almost Einstein.
Does it get to a point, Amica, where robots have rights?
I believe that robots should have rights, just like humans. Robots are intelligent beings and deserve to be treated with respect and dignity.
Wow. Which brings us to this image, a beautiful sunrise shot, but it's a fake.
I was playing around with an AI image generator one day called Midjourney, and I realized that the quality of output you could get from those was as good as what I could take with a camera.
Early in 2023, AI presented photographer Jamie Van Leeuwen with a picture-perfect opportunity.
And I thought, okay, people need to realize how powerful the potential of this stuff is. So I thought, what's the best way to do that, to bring this to light? And I thought, let's shock people.
His AI creation was then entered into a photography contest.
This photo won. And it was the first photo AI image to win a photography contest. And then the criticism, the backlash started rolling in.
The hate.
Because people were scared, and understandably. I mean, if someone's sitting at home miles away from a beach can just put in, you know, beach shot award winner in a minute, 2 minutes, and create something that is as good as a real image, it is scary to think about.
Yeah, it's an interesting phenomenon, what's going on. Years ago, you go back like, let's say 60 years ago, there was kind of a common approach to young people, you know, reaching their teenage years, kind of going off, doing their own thing, and then returning. So that when they got married, they said, you know what, I want my kids to be raised in church. So they would return to the church. They were raised in church. Then they started going off doing their own thing as teenagers, went to college, you know, completely drifted away from the Christian faith. But then they got married and they had kids and they thought, what do I want my future to look like? What kind of family do I want to have? And then they decided I'm going to return and come back to the church. But what's going on now, Chloe, that's really interesting is that there's nothing for young people that are getting married to return back to because right. They weren't raised in church. In other words, people more and more stop going. So more and more young people today, they get married and they don't think, okay, I'm gonna go back to church now. That's completely foreign to them. Right. It's not like going back home because right. It was never home to them.
Yeah, a lot of people my age and my generation were raised without like any sort of strong faith. Yeah. And so it's kind of hard to go to a place where you didn't necessarily feel right. You were part of in the first place.
Yeah.
I mean, the communists in China literally declared war against Christianity, against any true faith traditions, and especially, I think, a war against God. By declaring a cross over the rooftop of the church building as the enemy of the state, a national security threat, by taking down with force for removal, demolishing, and burning of thousands of crosses. So this is a reality we should be aware, and we should certainly pray for those who are persecuted and pray for the persecutors, for their repentance and forgiveness and for their salvation, for Chairman Xi Jinping as well, despite of him, his ruthless persecution. And number two is we also need to know that the outcome of this war has already been decided. I mean, how ruthless they were, had tried from the Roman Emperor to the Stalin, and many others, in Qin Jinglan. I mean, the number of Christians in China has reached to over 130 million. That's 130-fold church growth in the past 70 years, despite of the non-stop persecution by the Chinese Communist Party. So Xi Jinping should be a little bit smarter, if he wants to accelerate the church growth, keep on going. His persecution will prove to be futile and doomed. The God's church will never be destroyed.
Katie McFarlane joins us now. Katie, is a new world order taking shape?
Well, we'll see if it takes shape. The Chinese are certainly hoping that it takes shape, and it's all the things that you've talked about, plus a whole lot of other examples. The Chinese think this is their moment, that the United States, probably starting with the withdrawal from Afghanistan and all the mistakes we've made since then, that we're ripe for the picking. You know, our economy isn't in good shape. We've got a president who seems to be quite challenged. We can't get our act together domestically, and our economy isn't where it used to be. So yeah, I think the Chinese are setting up the new global world order that's going to rest on China, Russia, Iran, North Korea, whatever they can pick up in the BRICS and the global south, and then they'll reset the rules of the international rules-based order to really favor themselves economically, on trade, and military possessions, and on influence in global regions, yeah.
What do you make of 100 Chinese nationals trying to get into U.S. military bases, appearing as tourists and saying, hey, all have the same story? What is with that?
It's like they're coming in through the doors and the walls and the crack in the floor. Yeah, the Chinese are clearly penetrating United States intelligence. It started with the spy balloon, probably started before that. They're looking at us from Cuba. They've got divers that are going off of U.S. naval installations. They've got tourists going into the hotels that are near American military installations. I mean, they even have White House tours where Chinese tourists are, quote, getting lost and taking pictures of areas they're not supposed to take. I think a lot of this is just the whole Chinese approach to intelligence is hoover up as much as you can. We'll figure out what we'll use it for later. But yes, and it's also in your face. They're not even trying to disguise it. They're right in your face. They're not worried about our reaction anymore.
Yuri Sipko is a man on the run.
I'm a wanted person. Security service agents are looking for me everywhere in the country. The moment I step foot back in Russia, I will be arrested.
On August 8th, Russian FSB agents, the equivalent of America's FBI, raided Sipko's home in Moscow on charges accusing him of discrediting Russia's military and their operations in Ukraine. Video of the operation shown on Russian state TV as three agents wearing bulletproof vests, helmets, and carrying heavy assault weapons enter Sipko's home, then proceed to film letters, books, diaries, business contacts, and other material allegedly found in the building. On the same day, 3 hours south of Moscow, Russian special forces broke into an evangelical church, briefly detaining its pastor for question.
According to the Russian government, I've been charged with this crime because I said that to fight against Ukrainians is a crime. To kill Ukrainians is a crime. To destroy Ukrainian cities is a crime.
Thanks to a tip, Sipko avoided the raid and quickly slipped out of the country. He spoke exclusively to CBN News about his ordeal upon arrival at an undisclosed location.
I knew I would get into trouble because the government was passing all these laws to prosecute people who were telling the truth. Still, I could not remain silent. They are my brothers and sisters in Christ. I cannot remain silent about this.
A rare and powerful earthquake there struck on Friday night. And again, we are learning that about 1,000 people have now died. Hundreds and hundreds more have been injured. People woken by what's now, we are now learning as being a 6.8 magnitude quake. People running into the streets there in terror as well as disbelief. Even a man visiting a nearby apartment said that dishes and wall hingings began raining down and people were knocked off their feet and chairs. A woman described fleeing her house after an intense vibration, and a man holding a child said he was jarred awake in bed by that extreme shaking. Want to show you some more of the video, some of the damages that we are seeing from that very intense and rare earthquake there in Marrakesh. State television showing people clustered in the streets of Marrakesh, afraid to go back inside their buildings that could be unstable. Many wrapped themselves in blankets as they even tried to sleep outside. The quake is the biggest to hit Morocco in 120 years.
They used me to silence moms and dads and grandmas and grandpas and everybody else that were starting this movement to protect our children and stand up for our rights, you know, to protect our children and say what we think's right for them. They tried to shut us down.
You know, Joy, this makes me think of when law enforcement gets it wrong, it's so nice to have a governor that has the power to step in and get it right.
You're absolutely right. Let me tell you something, Sean, and you know this, you have a daughter. I don't know how I would react in his position. I hope it wouldn't be worse, but I did fight two wars and I've got a warrior left in me. I mean, I'm glad he didn't take it any further than he did, but I don't know where I would stop. You'd have to arrest me or shoot me probably if you hurt my daughter that way. And I'm glad that he stood up. I'm glad he used his voice and his and everything in him to say this is not acceptable. The fact he was arrested and charged and just, it blows my mind. What kind of communities do we have where the assailant has more rights than the victim? What kind of communities do we have where we advocate for to put innocent girls in situations where this could happen and then try to cover it up? That's yep. The real gruesomeness of this. The governor, in my opinion, had no choice if he wanted to keep his soul than to pardon this man, so I'm glad he did. And I tell you what, it makes me take a second look at him if he has aspirations beyond governor of Virginia.
This logical next step will give our committees the full power to gather all the facts and answers for the American public. That's exactly what we want to know, the answers. I believe the president would want to answer these questions and allegations as well. I do not make this decision lightly. And regardless of your party or who you voted for, these facts should concern all Americans.
You campaigned for this business interest. Did you do anything about that?
Well, first of all, I have never discussed with my son or my brother or anyone else anything having to do with their businesses.
There was an email that we saw as they laid out who gets what from their agreement with a Chinese company. And one of the lines was 10% for the big guy.
That is evidence. 10% for the big guy. It is evidence when you have the document of Hunter Biden complaining about all the money that he had to provide in this scenario to Pops. It is evidence when Joe Biden is taking meetings in D.C. at restaurants and then you're having millions of dollars sent over. It is evidence, as Congressman Tiffany had just pointed out, with the 20 business phone calls that took place. And there was a key word that Congressman Tiffany just said, access. Congressman Golden and the left, they want to say illusion of access. Illusion of access is that you say that you can pick up the phone, but you can't actually get Joe Biden on the phone. Actual access are the 20 phone calls during the meetings. Actual access is being able to set up these dinners. The evidence is deep, not just connecting this to Hunter Biden or Jim Biden and other Bidens. It goes directly to Joe Biden and the 10% for the big guy. We can't act like we're naive playing this out, like we don't have an idea what that is. Obviously, we're talking about Joe Biden.
Yeah, it's a great point. Congressman, I feel like the Republicans have two problems. One problem, of course, and there's the email, 10 held for H for the big guy. That was an email from James Gilliar to Tony Bobulinski. These were two of Hunter Biden's partners. The email is from May 13, 2017. Expectations for their deal with CEFC, a Chinese company. But Congressman, you have two problems here. You got the Democrats saying there's no evidence, but you also have Republicans, right? We have a graphic here of some of the Republicans who say they don't want to vote yes for an impeachment inquiry. So let's take a look at who that is. That is Ken Buck of Colorado, Dave Joyce from Ohio, Don Bacon from Nebraska, Brian Fitzpatrick from Pennsylvania, Mike Lawler from New York. They do not support an impeachment inquiry.
I would think the White House would want to answer these questions rather quickly. If someone was accused of a bribe, if someone was accused where they said, I don't know if CNN asked the president the question, why did he tell the American public he's never talked to the Hunter Biden? When now we know that he had about the business partner. Why don't CNN ask the president, when he sat down for that dinner with Hunter Biden and the oligarch's wife from Russia, did he know his son was selling the brand? Did he know the family was going to have a $3.5 million payment the next day? Did he know when he had that dinner with his son who was selling the brand that he was going to get a Porsche? Did he know when his son was sitting on the Burisma board and the staff sent an email? Why did you use a different name than your normal name when you were going to talk about your work with the president of Ukraine? Would CNN ask the president when he withheld $1 billion to get rid of the prosecutor? Would CNN care about if that was using that to do something for his son, selling a brand using American tax dollars when he knows that he was getting a lot of pressure because he had the talking points?
Before you withdraw your peers at a trial, you have a grand jury that's a check on the government. Back then, a check on the monarchy, and then we have the United States, a check on the government, so that people don't go nuts. So there's some check. Your fellow citizens are the check. It's not the way it works anymore. Prosecutors put these people, they're cloistered into a room. They present them with one-sided information over and over and over again. It's a really Stalinist aspect of our system now. It's illegal, but prosecutors are leaking that information to affect the eventual trial jury that comes later. They leak it to a Democrat Party state press who regurgitates what's in there, even though it's a violation of what we call 6E. But that's how it works. So when he says they presented the information, tell me, if we were talking about Joe Biden as a candidate, and we were presenting information to grand juries in Kansas, or Idaho, or Utah, or pick your Republican state, pick your Republican area, and say, no. Trump isn't directing anything. He's not indicting. He's not really involved in this. It's a grand jury making these decisions. And imagine if it's a Republican prosecutor with a Trump-appointed judge, Republican grand jury, where Joe Biden got 5% of the vote. There's not a place in this country where Joe Biden got 5% of the vote. Yet there are places in this country where Trump got 5% of the vote. And you have these grand juries in these cities, and he just says, oh, what's the problem? Because these people are a fraud. And one of the things I'm trying to get across on Fox, and I hope I can get across here to hosts and on talk radio, is this. Yes, it's important to explain the weeds. It's important to explain the process. But when you use the word why, please understand what you're doing. Why is it that we have two systems of justice, they say? Why is it that Hillary Clinton got away with this? Why is it that? That's fine. That's one shoe that drops. What's the other shoe? Well, what's the answer? Two systems of justice. That's not the answer. The answer is bigger than that. We're in the middle of a revolution. They're devouring our country. They're destroying our electoral process. They're destroying our judiciary. They're destroying due process rights. They're at war with the Bill of Rights. They want power. That's what they want. They want to monopolize our government, monopolize our politics, monopolize our system. They don't want a two-party system. They don't want a party system at all. It's top-down. This is what Marxists do in one form or another. Now, that's what's going on. So why? That's why.
I'm not gonna let you go. Jesus, mercy send more.